We were doing all the right things. We knew each other's love languages. We were going on date nights. We were taking time away for just the two of us. We were doing all the right things. And yet infidelity became a part of our story. And what we realized is it wasn't the big things that were robbing us of intimacy. It was the little things.
Welcome to the Focus on the Family broadcast, helping families thrive.
Jen, we hear from so many couples who have come to the end of their rope. They don't see any hope for their marriage. Maybe there's been infidelity or some other trust broken or whatever it might be. There's a cooling of the relationship. The one that catches my attention is when people say, we just fell out of love. I mean, that's so unfortunate. What I like to say is, well, that's because you weren't working at it. Marriage takes discipline. It takes effort. It doesn't just happen. It's not, just coming out of the ground and you're loving each other endlessly. It takes effort. And it is such a tragedy in our culture today that we have removed God from His plan for marriage. I mean, He's the one that designed it. I often smile because, man, He's got a knack for pulling opposite people together. I mean, He has wired it that way. Introvert meets extrovert. I love you. And you're looking for something that's different from you. And I think that's inherent in us. It's what God placed there. And rightfully, the question is, why did He do that? I think the answer is so you could become more like Him, because it's going to require selflessness to be successful in that marriage. Mm-hmm. And He's smiling going, I've done a good thing, because you're going to learn more about who you are and become more like me. If it works.
Well, sometimes those differences really don't work out and couples find themselves in trouble. This quick reminder that here at Focus on the Family, we have resources and tools, we have counselors, and we have our Hope Restored Marriage Intensive. We have a lot to offer couples who either need some minor tune-up with regard to the relationship or major overhaul, because those differences are becoming more and more profound. And so let me encourage you to call us. Our number is 800-A-FAMILY, or stop by focusonthefamily.com/broadcast to learn more.
Today we're going to talk about deeper pain and those things that were causing difficulties in the Savages' marriage. To give that little bit of background, they were in public ministry. Jill was the founder and CEO of Hearts at Home. Mark was a pastor for 20 years. They would write and speak on family issues, helping save the marriages of others. And at the same time, their marriage was crumbling. Let me welcome both of you back to the broadcast. Mm. What an introduction, right? Your marriage was crumbling. But you know what's so good about it? And we're going to get there. Here you are today.
Mm-hmm.
You're
absolutely
at the table. You're together. Mm-hmm. You're still married.
Yeah.
And
right.
I just give you so many accolades for fighting through that and doing what the Lord would want done, even in difficult circumstances.
Mm-hmm.
Mark, we left off last time where you were just beginning to share 28 years into your marriage. You were burned out. You left the pastorate. You're depressed, really. I mean, that's what it sounded like to me. You were in a midlife crisis. Jill, years before, had had this heart flutter for a coworker. She came to you and said, I'm experiencing this. You responded with gentleness, with wisdom. Let's fix this. We've got to get it taken care of. Jill left her job, got out of that situation. But now years later, you're the man, as Nathan said to David.
Mm-hmm.
You're the one.
Yes.
Describe briefly what took place, and then we'll go to the healing portion.
What took place was my disillusionment and mistrust of God was at the core of all of this. And it played out in experiencing or believing out of my own brokenness that my marriage was just too hard. Life was too hard. It wasn't worth it. I needed to start over. I needed something new. I took the steps to pursue something new. I found a new relationship. I left Jill and my kids, and I'm sorry.
No.
Wow. I left Jill and my kids believing that that new relationship was going to be the cure-all. But the problem was I took somebody with me, and that was me. And pursuing this new relationship, what I so am so grateful for is that God just kept pursuing me, and the door opened for me to realize how powerful my flesh had been and that I hadn't learned how to really deal with the flesh, and also how much God wanted me to be free of me.
Jill, turning to you, I mean, wow, this is tough stuff. This is probably the arrow that pierces a wife's heart the deepest, mm-hmm. the most profoundly. It's the trust factor, it's violation. Mm-hmm. It's, I can feel that in the letters we read here at Focus or the emails when it just devastates, because what does a woman think when this happens? You turn it to yourself. Where did I fail? Mm-hmm. What was my problem? Mm-hmm. I mean, it's a beautiful thing, but man, it crumbles you.
Mm-hmm. You do naturally, think, what am I not providing? What am I, what do I need to change? All of that. And I would say that probably filled my mind for probably the first 2 months after discovery. But there was a turning point for me where I moved it in my head and my heart from being about me to recognizing the confusion that he was in. And I think honestly that's what allowed me to stay in the game for a while, because I began, instead of making it about me, I made it, I began to have compassion upon him.
That fork in the road, though, between finding and growing in compassion versus the bridge of bitterness, when you're standing there,
scary.
I mean, it's not like a stoplight. It's coming mm-hmm. from within. Mm-hmm. Some people would say, I couldn't control that bitterness. I was angry.
Mm-hmm.
He violated me in so
absolutely.
Many ways. How do you choose to follow God through this dark path?
Well, I think the number one thing you do is pour your heart out to God. I mean, you lay it out there and you express your anger to him. I mean, I just, many times just was in a heap on the floor of tears, bawling my eyes out, crying out, begging God to bring back the husband I knew that was in there but was so lost. So I think part of it is you've got to express that. And I had a handful of friends that were safe for me to be able to express that to and to process that with as well. So I think part of it is, being honest with God. And that doesn't mean it's not a clean process. It's messy.
Yeah.
It's really messy.
And don't pretend in that Mm-mm. process. Don't feel one way about your spouse and then turn to God and act a different way.
Mm-mm.
Bring
no.
that over. Talk to the Father.
You don't have
about
to get
that.
Cleaned up before you talk to him.
Yeah.
You just lay it out there. He knows.
He wants your heart.
And not only that, but Christ was betrayed.
Yeah.
I mean, you talk about somebody understanding betrayal, your God gets it.
Mm. How do you settle your heart down? How do you think through without giving a free pass
mm-hmm.
to your spouse to say that's okay so that it might happen again without any consequence? That's not healthy.
Right.
But how do you balance all that? And just speak to the spectrum of voices of women that you've heard from.
Yeah.
Hardcore, I locked him out of the house. He's never going to see his kids again. To the other end, where really was your response of, how do I fix this, Lord? What can you do through me?
Yes, I would say mine wasn't all the way over there, because the other thing, we were seeing a counselor when all of this happened, and he stopped going to counseling. I continued to go, and my counselor was helpful in me trying to figure out the balance between grace-filled love and boundary-filled love. And there had to be both. So, for instance, when he left, one of the things I did is I changed the locks on the house. And he couldn't come back in without calling me, making arrangements.
That was under that boundary category.
It was a boundary category because our kids were absolutely crushed. And I couldn't have him to show up and then have them drug through the emotions of dad walking in the door and them not being prepared for that. So that was one place where I had to draw some boundaries. But at the same time, to do it in as much of a loving way as possible.
As you could muster.
Right.
I mean, let's
and
be truthful.
Right. I remember one night when shortly after he left, one of the boys overflowed the toilet on the second floor, and it overflowed into the kitchen and down into the basement. Mm. And I was alone at home trying to figure out what to do. And I'm going to tell you, I was not very happy with him at that moment, and I was not very kind. I mean, let's just be honest. Mm-hmm. I was ugly.
Right.
That
if
night.
Everything was normal, if you didn't fill
if
in
you,
the blank,
exactly.
You would be here to help us right now at our point of need.
Exactly. Mm-hmm. So I didn't do that perfectly well for in any way. But at the same time, tried very hard when we did set those boundaries, when I did set necessary boundaries, to do it in as loving way and with as much compassion as possible.
Mm-hmm. Our guests today on Focus on the Family are Mark and Jill Savage, and they've shared very candidly here on the air and in their book, No More Perfect Marriages. You can find the book and a CD or download of our conversation at focusonthefamily.com/broadcast. Call us if you need resources or you'd like to talk to one of our counselors. Our number is 800-A-FAMILY. Mark, you had you kind of pretty much in your mind decided, I am divorcing Jill, and yet you did still meet together, you still had conversations, and something happened in the course of what were, I'm sure, very tense get-togethers. God started to do something, right?
He did. I asked Jill to meet on a regular basis so that we had kids, we had to know how to have conversation about the kids, and during that time, Jill's love was what we now call or have coined unhumanable.
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 That's good.
And when Jill first, we were at dinner and I asked her, I've done so much to you. Why are you so nice? And then she said, well, all I can say is it's unhumanable. And I started to laugh, not at her, but that just sounded so odd and kind of cute. And we just, we learned that that is the love that God gives us for the compassion and grace and boundaries to just keep moving forward in the way that He wants, not in the way that the world would say.
Mark, had you ever experienced that kind of love that was unconditional and not from the flesh? Again, I'm thinking probably not.
No.
Because you only had aggression in your home.
Yeah.
Growing up. And here, your very wife is demonstrating you the attitude of Christ, maybe for the first time.
Mm-hmm.
That you could feel it.
I could feel it and see it. And so that was happening, and then God was cleaning up my own disillusionment and helping me to see the mess for what it was. And I was quite overwhelmed with all of that. But what it did was it led me to a powerful decision in my life, and that was surrender, which is way deeper than submission. But I found myself in a place where I couldn't fix it. Jill's high profile was huge, so I wasn't really reconciling only with Jill and my kids, but the thousands of women that she ministers to in the Scarlet A that I felt that I wore on my chest. And that took a tool that we identified in our book of courage. Courage to surrender fully to God and do whatever He says, no matter what.
When you look at it, and I want to get to some of the tools that you discovered and implemented to bring your marriage back together, the fades, you call them, and we'll get there in just a second. But when you, as a pastor, thinking of the 20 years you pastored, and Jill, what you do through your ministry to women, how many of us don't surrender? And it takes the crushing blow of sin and failure and brokenness to come to the throne without pretentiousness, without thinking we're better than the other person. I mean, it kind of is God's design, isn't it? Not that you need to go through this. You don't want to go through this. But if it happens, to ask the thing, the very first thing, God, what can I learn about you? And Jill, as I hear your testimony and your heart, and to be able to lay down that kind of what Mark saw as unconditional love, that's not coming from your flesh. That's because the flesh response, the human response is, I'm going to get you. And I'm going to stay mad at you for the rest of my life. And I will be bitter towards you. And it's not my fault. It's your fault. You violated me. You left me. You deserted me. I mean, you can hear it. That's the flesh talking.
It is. Yes.
And
it
yet
is.
God is saying.
And that's the feelings.
Yeah.
I mean, those feelings are there.
And we gravitate toward those. But God's quiet voice is, wait a minute, daughter, wait a minute. And fill in what he said to your heart. To allow you to act like that toward Mark.
Oh, I can remember the day I was literally begging God. I was on my knees and then eventually flat on the floor, face down. Like, I was home alone. My kids were at school. And I was just absolutely broken. And I kept saying to God, you have to tell me what to do. I don't know what to do. You have to tell me what to do. Tell me what to do. And I got quiet for a few moments after that, and I heard God whisper to my heart, I want you to love him. And I remember immediately I protested, and I said something to the effect of, I don't know if you've noticed lately, but he's not real lovable. And I heard God whisper back to my heart. It wasn't an audible voice. It was just his truth. You know what, Jill? Sometimes you aren't either. And I thought, oh my goodness. Okay, Lord. You love me when I'm unlovable. So you're going to have to show me how to do this because I got no clue.
Wow.
I had no clue. Yeah. And eventually, God took me to Romans 12, 9 through 21. Very powerful verse. It now has, in my Bible, I have the word unhumanable written out beside it because it really talks about how to love the hard people in your life. I've returned to that on many occasions outside of my marriage, because there are other places where there are hard people to love. But that was a very powerful moment. When that was the transition for me, where I really felt like, all right, Lord, I'm going to love him. I don't know how this is going to turn out, but I am determined that I will do whatever I can do to be the person you want me to be and to save my marriage if it's possible.
That's powerful. And it really is powerful. Listen, I want to put some tools in the hands of the folks who are going, you're touching my heart. This is me. I'm in that marriage right now. I can either call him or her tonight and say it's over, or I can try to ask God to give me that kind of love for my spouse. You mentioned in the book seven fades in marriage, and these were things that you, I'm sure, were already aware of, but now you're having to apply them on the battleground.
We weren't already aware of them.
So these are things you learned in the process.
Because here's the deal. We were doing all the right things. We knew each other's love languages. We were going on date nights. We were taking time away for just the two of us. We were doing all the right things. And yet infidelity became a part of our story. And what we realized is it wasn't the big things that were robbing us of intimacy. It was the little things, the things that were under the surface, things that were untapped, things that were untalked about. And those were pulling our hearts away from each other 1 centimeter at a time.
Wow.
So you don't see that. You don't feel that. But 1 centimeter becomes 2, and 2 becomes 3.
And worse, you feel spiritually healthy.
Yes.
You didn't feel unhealthy necessarily until the breach to the big, you know, the dam broke. Yeah. Let me mention the seven. We'll post these with your permission on the website as well. And you can pick one or two. And I want to get to a couple of other things that you discovered. But unrealistic expectations, that's a killer. Not accepting your spouse as they are. Okay, that's a
huge,
big one. Defensiveness. Another one. These are all so good. Avoiding emotional intimacy. I think men particularly struggle with that, particularly men with bad backgrounds, because we're Marines, right? We'll just, hey, we don't need to talk about it. We'll just keep moving. minimizing what matters to your spouse, disagreement, and simply naivete, the last one, not protecting your marriage. Mm-hmm. Those are good. They're almost self-explanatory. I mean, you know what they are when you say them. Give us one that you two struggled with.
I think minimizing is probably huge. And what we identified is we are two different minimizers. We've identified that there are external minimizers and internal minimizers. External minimizers tend to minimize the thoughts and feelings of others. And that tended to be where I sat. Hmm. I was quick to tell Mark why his feelings were wrong, and or his concerns were not important. Mm. So I would minimize that.
I struggled with internal minimizing. And what that is that core belief that what you think or feel, ultimately you aren't important, so just bury it. And I thought that I was just, I didn't understand that I was truly minimizing. I felt that I was not saying anything or doing anything, I was, in a sense, keeping the peace.
Doing the right thing.
Doing the right thing. It's really not that big of a deal.
Right.
But they compounded to the point that fueled this inner lie that I wasn't important.
That's a real critical one, I think.
Well, and I love one of the sentences you wrote in the book is, I thought I was letting it slide, but it wasn't sliding, it was pooling.
Correct. Mm. Yep.
And that ultimately caused that distance.
Right.
And that place where he said, you know what?
I'm done.
And that, I think that's what happens. And that's the danger of fades. That's why we wanted to write No More Perfect Marriages for all marriages, not just marriages that are in trouble. Because we all need to understand those places where our hearts are being separated in a way that we don't recognize it.
Right.
And the more we can do that and turn those fades around with the God tools, the powerful God tools that God gives us, the healthier our marriage is.
You know, again, we're out of time. There's so many great tools in here. Pride, the recognition of what pride does to you in your marriage. Mm-hmm. That was, I thought, profound. Mm-hmm. But these motivations, these statements, these attitudes are coming out of pride, even though we mask them so well in the Christian community.
Yes.
To where everybody around us doesn't know it, but we do.
Yep.
And then finally, hedges. Let's end there to give folks a glimpse of that. And then I'm telling you, everybody, get a copy of this book. It is packed with the tools, not just the tragedy, but the tools of how to repair and repave that pothole-infested road called a broken marriage.
Mm-hmm. Hedges flow from the slow fade of naivete. And in naivety, we ignore the potentials that could put us at risk in our marriage. And I struggled with that greatly. I would have lunches with women as a pastor, or I would meet with them behind closed doors. And all of that was fueled out of this prideful arrogance that I don't have to do anything to protect my marriage. I got this.
Because that'll never happen to you.
Yeah, I got this. And so Jill and I, we've identified hedges of protection to help people understand how to battle naivety.
So what are some of those rules?
Well, and that's the thing. You really resisted the rules. You thought they were rules and didn't value it from that perspective. But one that we definitely identify is being careful on social media. Because Mark's affair started when an old girlfriend reached out to him on Facebook and he had the conversation.
And that is so common today.
It is.
That is
the most
common.
And so
way.
You just need to make some decisions ahead of time that if that happens, I will not respond. It is wisdom because we just don't know those places where our heart is sensitive. Mm.
Another edge is not being alone with someone of the opposite sex, or if you're if you're working out and you want to do some additional training, train with someone of the same sex So you're not drawn to someone.
A buddy.
Mm-hmm.
Right.
And then in my job, I run a contracting company. I am never alone in someone's home. I always have the buddy system.
Right.
And that I do that with my crew members, too, that I want to protect them. And they may not even know it, but we're all susceptible to failure.
Well, and there's a good things to follow. What do you, if you want to call them a rule, or if you don't like rule,
principle
to follow, because these are protections. That's what a hedge does. Mm-hmm. It protects you.
It does.
Yeah.
That's the whole point. Hope is that thing that people, when they lose it, it's despairing, and it's hard to get up. It's hard to move forward. And so often with couples that are coming to our Hope Restored intensive counseling effort, that's the question. Do you believe there is hope that God can restore your marriage?
Mm-hmm.
And if they have no hope, it's hard to work with those couples. So the key is, even in your grief, in your darkest area, whatever that might be, do you have hope in your heart that God is God?
Yes.
That your circumstances don't dictate your hope? It's hard.
It is.
Because we live in our circumstances. We live in the moment with our eyes and ears.
Mm-hmm.
But God lives in everything and that too.
Mm-hmm.
And he's saying, can you trust me? Can you put your hope in me? Not your spouse.
Mm-hmm.
Put your hope in me. And Jill, you did it.
Mm-hmm.
And Mark, you did it too in different ways.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely.
You don't need the scarlet letter. We all wear that.
Oh, I know.
And God has...
you're past
taking
that
care
past
of that.
That yeah.
Well, and Jesus died for all of us because we're all sinners.
He took that on. Yeah.
And I just want to say thank you for that vulnerability. You're really good at that as a couple. And how many people you will help through this program. And if you're living in that spot right now, you don't know what to do, call us. We've said it throughout the program. We have kind, caring Christian counselors here. They'll start the process for you. If you need that deeper, intensive counseling, we have Hope Restored. They have an 84.7 post-2-year success rate.
Love that.
That's pretty good.
That's powerful.
It's excellent. And it's just equipping you to do better in knowing your own heart, knowing your flesh, knowing God's hope for you in Him, and then giving you those tools to live life better. And I'm excited for that. And thanks to all the folks that help support us, who make it all possible. Mm-hmm. Thank you.
You can call us, and we'd be happy to tell you more about Hope Restored, about the book No More Perfect Marriage, a CD of this program, and more. Our number is 800-232-6459, 800, the letter A in the word family. Of course, we have resources, links, details about all of this and more at focusonthefamily.com/broadcast.
Mark and Jill, thank you for your transparency, your vulnerability. Many, many couples are going to be touched by this, and it's because you've been able to share so honestly about who you are, because honestly, you're just like us.
Mm-hmm.
And I appreciate that so much. Thanks for being with us.
Thanks for having us.
Thank you.
And on behalf of Jim Daly and the entire team, thanks for listening. I'm John Fuller. We'll be back next time as we once again help you and your family thrive in Christ.